नमः श्री यतिराजाय विवेकानंद सूरये सच्चित्सुख स्वरूपाय स्वामिने तापहारिणे। गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल, ऑनरेबल जस्टिस श्री विजय सेन रेड्डी गारू, डॉक्टर कादर वली जी, श्री रंजीत रेड्डी गारू, श्री दिलीप रेड्डी गारू, श्री निशांत रेड्डी गारू एंड विकास एंड अदर पैनलिस्ट, डॉक्टर आचार्य गुप्ता जी एंड ऑल अदर डिस्टिंग्विश्ड गेस्ट फॉर पार्टिसिपेटिंग इन टुडेज वेबिनार। सो एट द आउटसेट आई एम एक्सीडिंगली ग्लैड टू बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस सेशन। आई थैंक विकास फॉर इनवाइट मी फॉर दिस सेशन। Yeah, we have heard some beautiful talks by Honorable Justice Vijay Sen Reddy ji and now Dr. Kadar Wali Saab. So I understand his concerns as a scientist. Yeah, it has become fashionable for all of us to talk about environmental protection while we are not interested to change the way we live. And he, Dr. Kadar Wali Saab, has said that spiritual people are also sick. They are also, because they are also eating the same food, of course. So whatever that is available, we are eating it. The thing is, he has pointed out rightly that it's spirituality, you know, that is the solution for all the problems of the world. It is true. Sister Nivedita, you all know, one of the foremost Western disciples of Swami Vivekananda, she made a statement with regard to Indian civilization. And she said, "The simplicity of Indian home is a deliberate choice of a highly cultured mind." I repeat her statement. The simplicity of Indian home is a deliberate choice of a highly cultured mind. Mahatma Gandhi also has made a famous statement. We all know that. Nature has everything for man's need and nothing for man's greed. We are greedily exploiting the nature today. All for what? Every creature from an ant to Brahma, they seek only one thing in the world, happiness, joy. So we humans are also seeking happiness and joy. And where are we seeking happiness and joy? We are not seeking happiness and joy in the self. We are seeking happiness in the material things. The Western civilization and its offshoots of urbanization and industrialization, they have a wrong understanding of life. That is, their understanding of life is human being is essentially a physical body, and the greater the comfort that you can provide to the physical body through material things, through appliances, consumables, luxuries, the greater is the joy the individual derives. Our rishis have told us long back that happiness is a state of mind and it has nothing to do with the material things as such. So that's why we have learned in this civilization culture to live in harmony with nature. For ages we have lived like that. So that great understanding the rishis has passed on to us, the great legacy. But post independence, we thought actually that's not a great understanding. We need to develop in the model of the West. And Mahatma Gandhi warned us, cautioned us again and again, and he said, "One man's food is another man's poison." The father of the nation said, "Don't industrialize, don't urbanize India in the model of the West. It doesn't work for India." But the people who came to power subsequently, they did not respect the wish of the father of the nation. I'm a bit blunt here to say that. They did not understand the sage in Mahatma Gandhi. And they were in a hurry to develop India. How to develop India? There are developed nations across. You just imitate them, things will work. That has been going on since independence. Had we followed, had we listened to the father of the nation, today we would have had an alternate model to show for the rest of the world. So this is the model, sustainable model. If you don't adopt this model, you will perish. We could have shown that to the West. But today we don't have an alternate model because we have been imitating them. We have nothing else to show. They have told us, "We are the developed nations, you are the developing nations, you are the underdeveloped nations, you are third world countries, you ought to imitate us, you ought to develop in the model of us. And we have subscribed to that thinking, hook, line, and sinker. And as a result, we have lost our traditional moorings. And now today, because of that aping, we are neither east nor west. We are kind of what you call chaos, India particularly. And as Dr. Kadar Walisa pointed out, economics actually is driving the world today. And it has become fashionable for us to talk about ecological conservation. And no country is interested to change the way they live, particularly America. The non-vegetarian food that they eat, they want to protect the rainforest in Brazil, but they don't want to stop eating beef. If you really want to protect, sorry, I think some noise disturbance is coming. If you really want to protect the rainforest, what they need to do is actually they have to change the food habit. Because to produce 1 kilo of beef or 1 kilo of chicken or kilo of pork or anything for that matter, a huge amount of energy you have to expend. And if you don't change the way you live, if you don't adapt to vegetarianism, it's also very important. But I'm saying, to conserve nature, to preserve resources for posterity, we need to turn inward. Once you develop the habit of meditation, prayer, selflessness, or repeating God's name, listening to good bhajans, what happens? You are joyful by yourself. You'll have less of material needs. In our Sanatana Dharma, we use this technical language called tamas, rajas, and sattva. What this human mind is made up of, I'm not talking about brain, I'm talking about mind. Human mind is made up of tamas, rajas, and sattva. So when there is predominance of rajas in an individual, he will become by nature an extrovert. So his idea of life is gather things as much as you want. That is the way to enhance your experience of life. So he will be, if he is dominated by tamas, he will be very indolent, very dull, very lethargic. He will not have great aims in life, or the zeal to come up in life or to achieve something big in life materially or in terms of wealth. The individual will lack initiative. That's the kind of thing. Only when you are endowed with sattva, okay, you are fulfilled from within. You will turn inward and you will seek your fulfillment. You will seek your experience of life, enhance your experience of life through prayer, meditation, selfless service, and through repetition of God's name. As you are joyful by yourself, you don't have to mess up with the world. You need minimum things from nature. But if that is not the case, you are predominantly of rajasic disposition, then your idea of success is to amass wealth, to procure as much as you can by competing with your fellow human beings. Then the rat race begins. You may become successful, but you will not become fulfilled. You may attain wealth. You may gain prosperity. You may gain all the best material things that are possible in the world, but still you will not feel fulfilled from within. Today, actually, human beings are trying to figure out what life is, as it were. So we are just actually exploring what life is. So how am I to get happiness? You see the kind of pleasures that we are inviting and the kind of addictions that are taking place in the world. Why? Everybody is desperately seeking a drop of happiness. Our rishis have told us again and again, oh man, amrutasya putra, they called us. You are by nature bliss absolute, not little happiness or joy. Your real nature is bliss absolute. That means the joy which doesn't diminish with time. When that is your real nature, what's the problem in discovering that? Because the Lord has created human being in such a way that paranchikani vetrunat svayambhu, the Upanishad says, tasmat paran pashyatina antaratma. The Lord has designed the human species in such a way. Our nature, all the senses are outward bound. They look outward and they actually seek the objects of the senses. And when the object of the senses come in contact with the sense, you will have momentary joy. Joy actually for a few minutes, a few seconds. As long as the object is in touch with the sense, and you will have some joy. There are tangible joys, that's why we are seeking them. But whereas the spiritual bliss, to get that actually, you will have to do sadhana. Meditation actually for that, you have to do sadhana. Selfless service actually for that, actually you have to exert yourself, right? Again, actually, to meditate, to selfless, do selfless service, to pray, or to repeat God's name. these are the things which we don't teach our children. If in a family in India today, India, actually Indians are supposed to be the most spiritual race on the planet Earth. Today, if you want to teach little spirituality, either in school or college, what happens? You teach little meditation in school and the child goes to home and actually start doing meditation. Parents come and complain to the management of the school. Why are you teaching meditation? This meditation has to be learned and has to be practiced after 60. Let my child enjoy the pleasures of the world. So they think, we see the dichotomy between materialism or, you know, the physical world, a secular world, and spirituality. That is again our problem. We think actually spirituality is against prosperity. Not at all. We'll have wealth as much as that is necessary. We'll have the basic necessities of life fulfilled. And afterwards, we don't know what to do. That's why people are accumulating. They don't know what to do with the things that they have already accumulated. But still, they want more. That means what? They have not figured out what they are. You are not figured out what this species, that is the biggest problem. And it is these people who are destroying nature. If you look at West, other day I wrote an article in our magazine, Sri Ramakrishna Prabha, where actually I wrote on vegetarianism and non-vegetarianism. India, even till date, actually continues to be the most vegetarian country, non-vegetarian country in the world. The average meat consumption, I mean, including all meat, pork, chicken, all put together, 5 kg, India. Whereas the average in the world is 45 kg. In America, it is 99 kg. In Australia, it is 95 kg. I mean, compared to them, actually, we are, the most vegetarian country in the world. Why I'm saying this? Because of that food habit, as Dr. Kadarwali Saab pointed out, because so much of extra calories you are taking, you are an extrovert. Your idea of joy and happiness is you have to derive from things of the outside world. So you'll become intensely rajasic. You have energy, but you don't know how to channel the energy. That energy keeps going outward. So you want to create machines. And you'll struggle. What? For what? To have an enhanced experience of life. To have a better experience of life. And you want more joy. And you have the idea that you'll get only when you have money and you have physical possessions with you. Then only you'll be joyful. Otherwise, you can't be in joy. That is the idea. Because so much of extra food we are taking, that too actually rajasic food, animal food, that actually keeps the senses go outward all the time. So to turn inward, actually, vegetarianism is of great help. And again, actually, we are saying today, the recent meeting, we all know actually in Glasgow, conference of parties, emissions we want to reduce, as Dr. Kadarwali ji pointed out, there's nothing like green technology, it's true. The electric vehicles, they say lithium batteries, where you dispose them off. You have to produce so many lithium batteries, run this, and then afterwards, where you will dispose. Solar panels, how you will create a panel. And to create a panel, whatever the material that is required to produce, you have to create another industry there. And also, we don't want to check our numbers. Population control, nobody is interested in. And we don't want to control our numbers. We don't want to change our lifestyles. And yet we want to preserve ecology and environment. This is only a fashionable talk. There is no way you can really preserve environment like that. If we have any genuine concern for posterity and future generations, the immediate need is to spiritualize the entire mankind. The Rishi's idea that happiness is actually intrinsic to us, it is within us. We don't have to search for it outside. And if you teach in schools and colleges, meditation, prayer, and to be joyful by oneself, we have to develop the capacity to be in ourselves, to be with ourselves. Today we are restless. But suppose if you teach this, and we think actually he is not a yeshiva. Somebody does meditation, so he's withdrawing from society. Parents think like that, teachers think that you need to be extrovert, you need to be active. But today we are hyperactive. We just ask people actually just to be with themselves for 10 minutes, they're finding it difficult because they are not being trained in any kind of meditation, any kind of spiritual practice. And particularly our idea is that now in this society, this idea also is there with everybody, that spirituality has to be practiced after 60. Bhagavad Gita was taught in the battlefield to Arjuna. So life is a kind of battle in the sense you will have to battle with your own senses, battle with your lower forces. And further, Krishna actually taught Arjuna the doctrine in the battlefield. And now we have the idea that we need to take all these ideas of the 60, and spirituality is antagonistic to development. Spirituality is antagonistic to prosperity. Spirituality is antagonistic to Abhyudaya. So those who seek Nisrayasa, they are of a different kind. So they may be pessimists, or they may have lost in life. So that's why they have taken up the spiritual path. Not like that. Whether it is sannyasin or householder, irrespective of the station of life you are in, we are all seeking truth. We are seeking infinite happiness. We are seeking God, consciously or unconsciously. So-called spiritual people, so-called sannyasins or ascetics, are the people who are seeking the truth consciously. The rest of the people are also seeking the truth, but unconsciously. If you can make every human being on the planet Earth seek the truth consciously, we will help the world immensely. We will be able to preserve the ecology and environment. We will not destroy nature, because we will take only as much as that is necessary for bare survival. And afterwards, my joy is in myself. Through prayer, I derive highest joy. Through meditation, I derive highest joy. Because, as Vivekananda says, each soul is potentially divine. The goal is to manifest the divinity within. There is potential divinity in every one of us. All the mystics of all religions have experienced that. We have Sufi mystics, we have Christian mystics, we have Hindu mystics. All these mystics have experienced. They have experienced the highest joy from within. For example, if you take Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, Vivekananda's guru, he was bliss personified. He would go into raptures and ecstasy. And sometimes, actually, some people, some guruhastas actually requested him, one of his nephew actually, Hridayaram, he requested him, "I don't know, Mama, Uncle, you are going into ecstasy so frequently. Why don't you give that experience to me also?" And Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa said, "It will come in course of time. You have to do sadhana and you have to let go your limited and little individuality or ego. Then you will experience it by yourself. So you have to prepare yourself. Without that preparation, even if I give you that experience, you won't be able to digest," he said. But this Hridayaram would not listen. He went on pestering his uncle. "You give me little, you give me little. Make me have the same experience, at least for a few hours." And one day, Sri Ramakrishna, out of his infinite compassion, touched his nephew, Hridayaram, to have that highest experience. It was such a joy. He started jumping and jumping and jumping. "Oh, Mama, there is so much of joy in me and in every one of us. We have to invite everybody. Let us invite everybody and let us ask everybody and to get this experience." Then Sri Ramakrishna touched him gently again and I said, "Fool, you wait. I've been experiencing this all the time and I'm not jumping like that. The little experience I had given you, but you could not control the joy of it." And they said, even Buddha, on that day when he had the highest experience in Nirvana, okay, he could not contain the joy. You know, you can say that the people are not able to contain, not able to digest the misery, but that Buddha actually found it difficult to digest the joy of it, the experience of it, because you can't express in words the joy of Nirvana or the joy of self-realization. And if you can make people consciously seek that, all these mystics, what they're teaching us, Buddha, what did he do? He just gave up the throne and took up the begging bowl. For what? Because he had the understanding that actually, thus sitting on the throne and ruling a kingdom, ruling vast mass of population is not going to give me that true fulfillment or true joy. I have to find it for myself elsewhere. He could find out that desire actually is the root cause of misery. Let me pluck out the desire and see what happens thereafter. So he went and sat and sat and meditated and meditated, struggled with himself and conquered the desire. And then he found out that consciousness, which actually is beyond the mind, beyond the pairs of opposites, beyond this limited little individuality or ego sense. And then he declared that actually there is suffering in the world. The root cause of suffering is desire, and conquer desire and you'll get the bliss of Nirvana. And we have a number of such examples. All the mystics, all the sages have given the same teaching. Absolutely, there is no dichotomy. No two sages have actually spoken differently. So why have we not made these spiritual values a part of our educational curriculum? Why have we not thought these great spiritual values of Rishis have been speaking for the last 10,000 years, through education, through school texts? Why have you put actually these material goals? What is our idea of success today? Our idea of success is to make money. If you are the richest man on the planet Earth, you will get the greatest respect, because you are the most successful. How you have achieved that success in the process, actually, how much of violence you have done consciously or unconsciously, how many people you have elbowed out, and all those things are not taken into consideration. this gross idea of success. Success means your enormous wealth, your big pocket, and then you're a successful human being. Otherwise, you're not a successful human being. This is all wrong way of defining success. So we need to redefine the idea of success itself. How joyful you are, how peaceful you are. If you can radiate peace, if you can radiate joy, if you're kind and if you're compassionate, then you're a true human being. So that is a true wealth. If you have this wealth, let us say actually you're truthful, you're righteous, you have kindness, you have compassion, you're being, you're Catholic. So you have the selflessness in you. If you have these virtues, gods will feel jealous of you. I'm sure human beings will not feel jealous of you because they can't understand what wealth you have, what wealth you possess inwardly. But I'm sure, I tell you, that gods will feel jealous of you because you are very close to God. These devas sitting in heaven, they feel jealous of such an individual who have truthfulness, who have honesty, who have righteousness, who have kindness, who have compassion in him, because this person is very close to God. And they don't want individual to become, you know, to go to God that fast. And so they will create all kinds of obstacles for that. So these are the things, the subjective values we all can cultivate. They don't cost us anything. But are we struggling in that direction? The subjective dimensions of life we are totally ignored. A poet enjoys a lot of life. A mystic enjoys a lot of life. An artist, a philosopher, because no material things, but they're so joyful. They're happy by themselves. Because we are not giving this training. I mean, training the imagination. We have that beautiful faculty of imagination. Today, we don't know how to train it. People are imagining all sorts of things and suffering. Everything they have. But you are not being taught how to train your imagination. You can train the faculty of imagination in such a way that no material thing is around you. But you are just your imagination is so rarefied and so ethereal and so beautiful. You will get the highest joy by yourself. So these are the things that we need to teach. These subtle things, actually, that managing the subtle body, basically the mind we call. So managing the subtle body, if it is taught through spirituality, individuals will be able to remain in joy by themselves. So it doesn't take anything. It doesn't cost you anything. So we will be able to make ourselves blissful, make ourselves joyful through these spiritual processes. And also, even if you want to material prosperity, if you want to become a leader, so once you have mastered your own mind, so it becomes easy for you to master our minds. Master in the sense, other minds. Master in the sense that you'll be able to understand them better. So there will be qualitative improvement in your interaction with others also. So the spirituality will help you to become a better leader, to become a better human being. And then you will be consciously creating wealth, that too, as much as you need, that much only. And even if you create more wealth than you have, than you need, you will share it with others. But otherwise, actually, you'll become a selfish human being. You have created wealth. That wealth you cannot really enjoy for yourself. And at the same time, you can't part with others also because you're selfish. Neither you can enjoy it for yourself, nor you can part with others because you have selfishness in you. And that kind of wealth actually will not give you any joy. So this spirituality, I think actually the solution for all the problems of the world at a psychological level, whatever the suffering that we are having, that the reason is, particularly in India, in the name of secularism, we have, mortgaged the soul of the nation as it were. I'm not mincing words here. I'm a bit blind. I'm sorry. But I just want to tell you, we have paid heavy price in the name of secularism. The Indians actually have been traditionally mystics and the descendants of sages have become pure materialists today. And that is our idea of success because society worships this kind of success. And everybody actually is getting into that kind of rat race where I want a good education. For what? I want to have more money. For what? Actually, I'll have more things. So that my life will be more joyful. But that is not the way life is designed. We understand the fundamental way, the way how the life is designed, I think it becomes easy. The larger population is still yet to understand. And as Vikas said, we have started this Arajanani for that purpose only. What I see is a lot number of people are born with rajas in them. And that is the reason actually they seek happiness outside. If the child is born with the prayer of the mother, like Vivekananda said, my mother and father prayed 2 years for me and then they brought me into the world. And thus such individuals will become spiritual and they will impact the society significantly. In a positive way, they will impact. So we have started this Arajanani with the purpose of creating a great society because great human beings make great society. What makes a human being great? We need to bring sattvic people into the world. People who are actually very energetic, but not restless, what I'm seeing actually. So very energetic, but not restless. They have the power to create wealth. but they consciously create wealth, not that desperately they strive to create wealth. That will not be their sole goal, sole objective, but they will be able to create if they ever wish. Vivekananda, if he wanted, he could have created. He could have become the monarch of the world. So Buddha, if he wanted, actually, was already monarch. So Gandhi, if he wanted, he could have created wealth. So all these people, actually, they had the capacity to create wealth, to generate wealth, but they never went for that because they sacrificed themselves for the sake of rest of human beings. And that's why they become great and they become Mahatmas. So it is possible that we can create a better society and better world when the actually mother prays for a great child. So if mother actually brings a child with sattva into the world, a well-behaved child will come into the world, and that child will understand spiritual values and spirituality. And otherwise, actually, it is very difficult. And you just see the world and the idea of success that the world, you know, today has. And we are trying to change that, but people, they don't subscribe to that view that easily, because there is no sattva. That what I see, they're intensely rajasic. Their idea of success is accumulate, make more money, make more properties, okay, make more wealth. The society respects that. And ultimately, at the end of the day, society may respect you, but you won't feel fulfilled from within. You won't feel that joyful from within, because that's not where actually happiness lies. Happiness actually comes through sharing. Happiness comes through love. Happiness comes through kindness. Happiness comes through compassion. Happiness comes when you connect yourself with God. God, I don't mean God sitting in Vaikuntha somewhere in heaven. God actually is dwelling in every creature. And once you connect yourself to God, every creature becomes an object of God for you, a form of God for you. And just imagine when you have this kind of understanding, when you have this kind of outlook towards life, where every being, every creature, every face is a face of God for you, the joy that you derive at that point of time, when you have that kind of outlook, is immense. That cannot be described in words. Today, it's an intellectual understanding for us, and we have to get into experience. Once we bring it into experience, you will have the highest nirvana or highest bliss. So I'll just conclude my speech by quoting one of the, it's not Albert Einstein's quote, but I heard he kept this quote in his drawing room, and I used to look at it every day. So what is that? Not everything that counts can be counted. Not everything that really counts can be counted. And not everything that can be counted really counts. That means not everything that really counts can be counted. For example, truthfulness, as I said, honesty and kindness, compassion, generosity, these are all the virtues. They cannot be quantified. They cannot be really counted. But they alone count at the end of the day. Because when we leave this world, what comes with us is only the good karma that we have performed. Nothing follows grave, save your spiritual practices, save your merit, save your good karma. And not everything that counts can be counted. Really, not everything that can be counted really counts. Things like wealth, physical wealth, properties, we can count them, but they don't really count when we die, because they don't come with us. So if we understand this, and if we accumulate spiritual wealth, and actually you are really provided for your next birth also, when that becomes your objective and goal, when everybody wants to provide for the next birth as well, not for this birth alone, not for this physical body alone, okay, there is a reincarnation. The good karma that you perform in this birth actually determines the next birth for you. And for a human being to get again human birth is not easy, because from hereafter actually law of karma comes into force. Up to in animals, there is no law of karma. For every good action, actually, you will go forward towards God, towards truth. For every bad action or wrong action, actually, you slip down the ladder, and it's possible you will come back to subhuman species, or you will evolve into a greater species, and greater species will become a god, and then ultimately you will become one with the Brahman. There is a small story. One day, actually, Mother Rukmini was serving dinner to Krishna. And suddenly Krishna went into laughter. He burst out into laughter. And Mother Rukmini asked, actually, "Oh Krishna, why did you laugh? Generally, Krishna doesn't laugh without a reason." I laugh like that," he said. But she insisted, no. Nobody actually who is a fine gentleman should not laugh like that. So your laugh means there is some meaning. Please tell me. She insisted. And then Krishna said, "You just see that centipede." The centipede was crawling away there. "Yeah, what is there?" "Tail is, I have seen so many centipedes," she said. "This centipede, I just wanted to see actually how many previous births it had. And when I was seeing its previous births, 21 times it was born as Indra. That means this centipede actually reached up to the level of Indra 21 times, and then actually from there it fell down. So the life is like, you know, that snakes and ladders game, you know, from human birth onwards. It's not only ladders that you, you know, steadily you ascend higher and higher, and then you achieve, you know, Brahman or infinite consciousness. Consciously you have a struggle. Any action that makes you progress Godward is a good action, and any action that makes you, you know, go away from God actually is a wrong action, Vivekananda defines. So if we can control our, consciously control our actions and accumulate more of good karma, we will spiritually evolve, and we become spiritual, and automatically we'll save environment, because I need very little for my physical sustenance only. The rest actually is my problem. Whether I keep my mind joyful and happy or miserable, that is in our hands. Nothing to do with the physicality, nothing to do with the physical things. Everybody has this kind of understanding. I think we can create a beautiful earth with beautiful human beings. We all should strive for that. And that's the reason we have started this Arya Janani. And we want to create a great mother, because great mother brings great offspring. A great offspring is he or she who is actually spiritual by birth. And because they have that spiritual understanding, you know, they will impact the society in a positive way. So thank you for listening patiently to my talk. And I'm thankful to Vikas and Nishant Reddy Garu for giving me this beautiful opportunity to share a few of my thoughts with you. Thank you so much.